everybody, welcome to my YouTube channel. In today's video, we are going to be reviewing 10 questions you should ask before purchasing a doll. And I'm making this video because my friend Cynthia asked me, do you have a video about the questions you should ask before buying a doll? And I was like, no, I don't, but that's a great idea. So these are 10 questions that you should ask before you purchase a doll. Number 10, I'm actually going to put this question on you as the purchaser. You need to do a thorough investigation about the doll that you're wanting to buy. So let's say, for example, now this, you should do this if you're going to buy a doll from an artist or if you're going to buy a doll from the secondary market from another collector. So let's say, for example, that you're looking at purchasing an Anna Salvador full set doll. What you would want to do is you would want to do a lot of research about that doll. Find out what accessories should she come with. You know, what are the pertinent things that you need to know about this doll? And the way you can find that is she has a website. Anna Salvador has a website. She has an Instagram. And there's a Facebook group where members who are collectors of her dolls, you know, can come together and ask questions. So if there's questions that you have, you should definitely do your own research first, because your own research can save you a lot of time and heartache in trying to find information that's already readily available out there. And you should definitely read. If an artist is putting a doll up for sale, so let's say she's putting dolls up for sale, read the full description of what is posted along with the sales post. You have no idea how many times I see on a sales post somebody ask a question on the post that's answered in the body of the sales post. I know it's easy to get excited when you see a doll up for sale that you really want, but make sure you thoroughly read everything there. If you're buying from another collector and it's not an artist, you wanna make sure you look, if it's somebody that you don't know. So a lot of times if I buy from other collectors, it's somebody that I already know, and so I kind of know their, you know, I know their history of collecting and things like that. But if it's somebody that you don't know, you may want to go look at feedback forums and find out, does this person have feedback? You want to look at their, maybe their Instagram account and see, you know, what kind of other dolls does this person have? Has this person been to a show where they would have bought this doll? You know, things like that. So you want to really do your own research first before you start asking questions. You want to ask the questions to yourself. You know, find out everything that you want to find out about the artist before you pursue any further. Find out about the other person. Are they a good seller? So that is number 10 on the list of things you should do, or the questions you should be thinking about before purchasing a doll. Number 9 question, and this is one that I almost always ask pretty close to the front of the conversation, is what payment methods does this person accept? Because one thing for Popovi dolls, for example, they only accept wire transfers. Now, if you're in the United States, sending a wire transfer abroad is extremely expensive. It cost me $45 per wire transfer to do a transfer for, you know, to purchase one of these dolls. And so somebody had asked me one time, do they offer layaway? Well, they do offer layaway, but I would never split the payment up because it costs me so much to send a payment out of the country. I want to pay it all in one go, and I don't want to rack up, you know, $180 of wire fees because I sent a payment in 4 separate installments. So you always want to ask what payment method somebody accepts. Usually people are going to accept PayPal, and that is the safest route to go because PayPal is going to protect you. You'll have your buyer protection. Sometimes people will ask you to pay friends and family. Now, I do use friends and family with sellers that I know and trust. These are people that I already know, people I've done business with before, people that have a good reputation within the community. If somebody that I don't know asked me to do friends and family, that has actually been a, you know, I didn't buy the doll before because of that, because, you know, there's so many scammers out there, unfortunately, even within the doll community, that you don't want to be sending money, friends and family, to someone. There's also people who will just charge you the PayPal fees on top, which is, it's fine. There's some artists, actually somebody was recommending me there's some different artists in Russia. You can either do wire transfer or you can pay with PayPal, but add 7% PayPal fees, Well, if it's a $1,000 doll, a 7% fee is $70 on top of the $1,000. So it's kind of like, you know, you have to decide if the payment method that's available is one that you're comfortable with. Again, I definitely wouldn't do friends and family unless it's somebody that you already know, somebody that you trust, somebody that has a reputation in the community that they want to uphold. They wouldn't want to do anything to damage or risk that reputation. Another thing that I just want to mention during this topic is that I'm trying to get away from actually doing wire transfer payments, and this is why. Not only are they expensive, but there is no protection. Now, the Popovi sisters, of course, have an excellent reputation when it comes to dolls, but I always think about, like, the emergency situation. Like, what if something terrible happens and for some reason they're no longer able to make dolls anymore? You know, what happens to your money at that point? You know, what if there's a serious economic or a serious natural disaster or something like that? You know, so there's no protection for you in that case. So it's just something that I kind of think about sometimes. And of course, I've had perfectly fine luck or perfectly fine, you know, it's been fine, but it is something that I think about a little bit in the back of my mind. Of course, with your PayPal cases, they're only good for so many days too. So you want to keep that in mind. Usually with artists though, it's fine. I'm talking more about if you're buying secondhand and you're buying from another collector, you really want to make sure that they don't tell you, you know, I want you to Venmo me this money, and then you have no protection on your end. So always ask what payment methods they accept before you kind of enter into an agreement or a commitment to purchase an item. Number 8, you want to ask and be sure of what accessories are included. I have seen many a sale go south because a seller will show a picture of a doll fully dressed with a wig, and they'll say in the, you know, in the description, doll comes nude with no wig, but people don't pay attention to that. They see the picture, they think they're getting what they see. So you want to make sure you're absolutely clear on what accessories are included. So for example, this is my Zia that I got from Eldoll in 2018, and she came with this wonderful outfit, and she also came with two pairs of feet. She came with the high-heeled feet, and she came with the flat feet, which were painted like her face up and hands. She had a different wig that she came with. It was also a Monique. This is a Monique wig. The wig she came with was also a Monique wig, so it wasn't anything super special. So if I were selling this doll, which I'm not, but just to show you, you know, you would want to make sure you detail which accessories are coming with the doll versus which aren't. And that's another thing for yourself when you're doing your research, like in number 10, if you were wanting to purchase this doll, you may want to look up and see, you know, from the artist's original Instagram back in 2018, what did this doll come with? You know, there were four of these dolls that were made, so you might want to know that. There were four of these made, and then she ended up making another one for somebody else, even though they were supposed to just be for Eldoll, so you might find that in your information, but there were only four of the full set Zia's made in this dark chocolate color with this outfit and feet. So that's part of your research, but it's also something that you want to ask about, you know, what accessories are coming with my doll? Because if a seller shows a picture of a doll that's not necessarily a full set doll from a show or from some kind of order or whatever, you may not be getting that outfit. So you may want to make sure to ask, and definitely shoes. Shoes are something that I noticed that people really almost never sell with the doll unless it's a, you know, an artist full set. So make sure you're clear about what accessories you're getting when you read through the description. And if it doesn't say, make sure you ask if the outfit that the doll is pictured in is really important to you. Make sure that you ask, is that outfit included? Number 7 is you want to ask about wigs and eyes. So this kind of goes with the last question, but it's a little bit separate. For example, Atelier Mimone's doll, her dolls generally come with her eyes. She either hand makes her eyes or she has a special eye that she uses for her dolls. And she almost always does Frappzilla wigs with her full sets or with her show dolls. So if you're buying a doll, you want to make sure, oh, and as far as accessories goes, if it's a doll that has ears like the Kitty M or like a lot of the Lilycat dolls have ears or other accessories like this, you want to make sure that those are included as well, if that's important to you. So it would be important to me. So you do want to ask about the eyes and wigs, because I've seen a lot of, especially in the Atelier Mimone crowd, when a dog is sold, they actually keep Lola's original eyes and they may replace them with another eye. So that's just something that I always like to kind of ask about. And normally people disclose that up front, you know, this doll's going to come with these eyes or what have you. But I really like to know, especially when their eyes like this. Now, some artists, you just get the random, you know, factory glass eyes or whatever. So I always just like to ask, you know, what eyes is the doll coming with? So eyes and wig, that's another thing that you want to think about. Is your doll coming with it? They almost always come with eyes. Wigs are, you know, sometimes yes, sometimes no, but you do want to find out which one your doll is coming with. Number six, if you're buying a doll that already has a face up, you want to ask, and if you like that face up and intend to keep it, you want to ask if the face up has any damages. If they're not clearly visible in the photo or whatever, that's a big thing to me because I don't like to send my dolls out for new face ups. I prefer to have an artist face up on my doll. So I'm going to show you an example of this. I'm going to take her wig off, but Nikki Britt's dolls, her big 18-inch dolls are notorious for having chips and scratches in their face ups, and you can see that on her, like on her lip, for example, there's a little chip there. I think she just didn't use as many layers of sealant when she did her doll face ups, but you know, this one is damaged. It's scratched up. There's paint missing. The end of her nose has got paint flakes that are gone completely. You know, she's got the little chip in her nose. So if the artist face up is important to you, or the factory face up that came with the doll, the face up in general that came with the doll, if that part is important to you, you want to ask if there are any damages to it. And most of the time the pictures will tell you the story, but you know, you may want to say, you know, is there any damage to the face up that's not visible in the picture, especially if that's very important to you. Now, if you're planning on having the face up wiped and redone, it's no big deal. That's not a question that's really important to you. Or if the doll is blank, obviously, that's not an important question either. But if the doll's coming with a face up that you really love and that's something that's important to you, that's something that you are going to want to ask in your questions before you purchase. Number five, if the doll you're buying is vinyl, so up to now we've kind of talked about resin dolls. Most of it's applicable to vinyl dolls as well, or any other type of doll. But if you're buying a vinyl doll, one of the big things that happens to vinyl dolls is they get shines in their faces. So if they get dropped, like I dropped Agapita here, she's a Corito Kids Agapita doll. They get shines in their faces, and you may be able to see this on her cheek. It's like a shiny scratch almost, where the vinyl bumps up against, she's got some on her forehead too, because I dropped her, or no, I think she fell off my shelf years ago and hit the floor. And so if it's a doll like this, those are kind of hard to get out. You can use micro mesh, or you can use like a magic eraser to try to buff some of it out, but it's really hard to get it all the way out. So if it's a doll like this, that's a vinyl doll that's got a vinyl or plastic face, you want to ask if there are any shine marks or scratches in the vinyl or plastic, because a lot of vinyl and plastic does get these. Vinyl gets more of the shine marks, and then plastic, like your ABS plastic, like Kiki Pops or Smart Doll Cortex are made out of, they can get like scratch marks. So if that's important to you, and I think it should be, especially around the face. Now the body I could care less about, but like the face of this doll, I would definitely disclose that if I were selling her. And anytime I've ever sold a vinyl doll, I definitely disclose if the doll has shine marks. And that's what we mean by a shine mark in the vinyl community, is, you know, does she have one of those shiny kind of scratches? But a seller may not know to disclose that. I have bought dolls before from sellers that were just selling their kids' dolls, and they didn't know that that was even important. You know, they're just thinking this is a toy. And so, and I didn't ask the question first, and because I didn't ask the question and they didn't really know, I didn't really find them at fault. It just was a situation that kind of sucked for me. But, you know, so if that's something that's important to you, definitely ask it, because your seller may not know, especially when you're collecting playline dolls like this, the seller may not realize that that's an important, distinction if the doll has those sorts of marks on their faces, because it is hard to get rid of. So make sure to ask if the doll has any shine marks if you're buying plastic or vinyl, or any scratch marks if that's important to you. Number four, if you see this doll and you've watched my channel for any amount of time, you know what this is going to be about. And number four is you need to ask, does the doll have any odors? That's a mistake I made when I purchased this doll, especially if the doll is wooden or plastic. Resin, I don't think holds odors as badly as some other materials. Wood holds odors the worst. And if you saw my video about this doll, I got her and she smelled like she had been in a smoker's home for the last 30 years. She smelled so bad. So if you're sensitive to odors, you definitely want to ask if the doll has been in a smoke-free environment. Along those same lines, if animals bother you, and you need to know if an animal has been in the home, that's a question that you need to ask as well. So if you have an allergy, I'm actually allergic to dogs, but it's not so bad that if a doll has been in a dog owner's home that it would bother me, but some people are very sensitive to cats, for example, and they just can't even have anything that's been, you know, within a foot of a cat, which means they shouldn't buy any of my dolls because, I mean, you can see what's going on here. But you definitely want to ask, and it's something I wish I had asked before I bought this doll. This is one of those examples. I got really excited about the doll and I bought her and I didn't ask the relevant questions. And when she got here, she smelled so bad. And it took me weeks and weeks to get the smell out of her to where I was even ready to let her out of her box and put her on display. So odors are very important to me. If you're not sensitive to odors, you know, that's something that's not maybe important to you, but I would definitely ask if there are any odors, if it's been in a smoke-free environment, and if the pet thing is important to you, you'll want to ask if the doll has been around any pets. Number three is you're going to want to ask about customs information. Now, in the United States, we don't pay customs fees for dolls that we bring into the country from other countries, so that's really not important for us. But I know that people in other countries do pay customs fees. Canada, the EU, the UK, all these countries do charge a customs fee for dolls that they're bringing into the country. So if you're going to be purchasing a doll and you're in a country that charges customs fees, you're going to want to talk with the seller about that. So it's really on you in your country to figure out what your customs laws and fees are, and that is up to you to determine, because I'm going to tell you right now, from the United States, I have no idea what customs is going to charge you if I send you a doll. Now, another thing that I'm not willing to do personally as a seller is that if I am selling a doll, I do not lie on a customs form unless the purchaser pays me friends and family. And the reason is because we cannot, in the United States, we cannot insure the doll. We have no kind of claim on the doll. If I send you, you know, this doll from the United States, and I'm using Melee by Connie Lowe because she is a United States artist and she sends a lot of dolls internationally to other countries. But if I were to send this doll and it got lost somewhere in the mail and I had marked on the customs form that it was only worth $50, I'd only be able to recover $50. And then if you decided to file a claim against me on PayPal, you know, I would lose all my money. And so that's something that I think you have to talk with your seller about if you're in a country that charges customs and you're purchasing a doll that's going to come from somewhere that a customs fee is levied on you. You have to discuss that with your seller and kind of figure out if they're going to mark the value of the doll down, mark it as a gift, things like that. For us in the United States, we're very lucky as of right now. We don't pay any customs fees on dolls and toys that come into the country. So it's not, you know, as applicable to us. But also, if you're buying from the United States and you can't understand why, you know, somebody won't mark something down on customs, that maybe that helps explain that a little bit, because, you know, we're not protected if it gets lost in the mail. And you guys know what a awful situation the mail has been lately, especially in this country. It's been so bad. So, you know, you send a doll out into the world. I had a situation where I sent a doll to a friend in Hong Kong, and I really thought the doll was lost. Really thought the doll was lost. I think it took, I want to say it was 5 months, but it showed up, and I was so happy, y'all. I was so happy when that doll showed up. But anyway, you just have to keep that in mind about customs, because if you pay customs in your country, that's going to be another fee that's added onto your doll at the end of the day when you go to pick her up or pick him up at the post office. Number two is you want to ask if the doll is coming with a certificate of authenticity. So for example, here's my Melba doll. Here's her certificate of authenticity. I keep all my COAs in this accordion organizer so that I can get to them quickly if I need to. You want to ask the seller, is your doll coming with that? Especially in this day where there are so many counterfeit dolls out on the market and you really don't want to buy a counterfeit doll by mistake. So definitely ask about the COA of the doll. That I think is so important to have. And COAs can be faked, of course, but you can always go ask the artist too if, you know, hopefully they'll respond. Some artists are very busy and don't have time to respond, but you definitely want to make sure that if you're purchasing a doll that you're getting a legit doll and that your doll is going to come with a COA so that you have that assurance that your doll is authentic and is not a counterfeit doll. And so I think that's one of the most important things you can ask for when you go to purchase a doll. And I always ask for that unless it's somebody that I know and I know how they, you know, where they got the doll. But generally speaking, I won't buy a doll unless it comes with a COA, unless, like I said, it's somebody that I really know and I kind of know what's going on with it. So always ask about the COA. The very last question that kind of goes along with the COA is the provenance of the doll. Where did the doll come from? Who has owned the doll before you? You know, where has it been? This is a perfect example of that. So I got this little Fee. I got her, it's probably been a year and a half or so ago. I honestly can't remember. But she did not come with a COA. But she was a really great price because there was no COA. But I did not want to buy a recast little Fee. So I asked, you know, the seller, where did this doll come from? And she told me the person that had sold her the doll. And so what I was able to do is it was a person that I knew, I didn't know well, but somebody that I knew that was in some groups I was in. And I sent that person a message and I asked, you know, I'm looking at buying this little Fee. And she was kind enough, she actually offered to send me her original receipts via email from Denver Doll where she had purchased the doll. And so once she sent me that, I was able to trace the provenance of the doll. I'm the third owner of this doll, so I know where she came from. I know where she was originally purchased. I know when she was originally purchased. I have a copy of the receipt from when she was originally purchased. So even though I don't have her box or her COA, I was able to track all that down, and then I felt comfortable buying her. Not only that, but I got a great deal because she came without a box and without a COA. So I would definitely recommend doing your homework and doing your research before purchasing a doll like this, especially that has been, there are so many counterfeits of this doll out on the market, and I definitely did not want to get a counterfeit. And so now I'm not saying everybody's not going to be as friendly and nice as that this particular collector was with me. So don't always expect that. But I have found generally in this community that people are always very friendly and nice, and they're very willing to help you, and they're very willing and open to talk about, you know, yes, this is the doll. I know I would be if somebody were purchasing a doll that I had sold to somebody along the way and it's changed hands a couple times. I'd be more than happy to talk with somebody about, you know, where the doll came from and how it came to be. So, and that's part of the reason, y'all, why I like to take so many pictures and I film my unboxings. So, you know, I will know back in time, this is where my doll came from. These are all the accessories my doll came with. This is what the COA looked like and stuff like that. So I can kind of, in my own mind, go back and see what I got with a doll and kind of track, you know, what's supposed to go with it. But I always find that knowing the provenance of a doll is good. So I like to know, you know, where the doll came from. If the doll is an artist full set, what show did it come from, or what Etsy shop did it come from, or, you know, how did you come to get this doll? So you can always find some sort of proof of purchase or something if the doll is a legit doll. And so I think that's very important if you're not buying a doll from the first-hand source. If you're buying it from a secondhand source on the secondary market, that's something that I personally like to find out, and I think it's worth doing your homework to do. So I hope that was helpful for those of you that are looking at buying dolls, either from an artist or on the secondary market. There are probably other questions that I didn't think of. These are just things that I might would ask, and sometimes these are not questions that I will ask. You know, some of those things aren't as important to some people as they, you know, might be to others. So it's whatever your comfort level is. I do a lot of research before I buy a doll. So you guys may have seen my Blythe video a couple videos back. I'm researching about Blythe, trying to figure out what kind of Blythe I want to buy. And so I put a lot of myself into my research before I purchase something. So that's something that I strongly recommend that people do, so you can, you know a little bit going into a purchase and kind of know what you're about to buy. So anyway, if I didn't think of a question, let me know in the comments below. What other questions do you always ask when you're buying a doll that maybe I didn't think of or I didn't include in this list? If you like this video, please give it a big thumbs up. If you're not subscribed, please subscribe, and we will see you guys in the next video. Bye-bye.